So guys, we'll be starting on with the topic that is certified ethical hacker fundamentals and techniques. And first we'll be starting on with the introduction. So I'll go for introducing myself. So I'm Monica Ehlavat. I'm a corporate trainer with Koenig Solutions. And as for my experience, I have been with Koenig for the past 2 years. And I'm also delivering trainings for technical courses like Certified Ethical Hacker version 12. I have also given trainings for incident handling, forensic investigation, Security Plus, some COMSIA courses, and you can further include security management courses like CISSP, CSSLP, CGRC. So that is about me. So then we'll move forward to today's agenda, what we will be discussing today. So we'll be discussing with ethical hacking. First, what is ethical hacking? How is it different from hacking? What are the different process, the steps within the process? What are the different type of attackers you might come across? What are vulnerabilities? Then a type of attack, which is social engineering. I'll also show you that. Then we have is malwares. What are malwares? Then types of malwares. We have APTs, advanced persistent threats. So we'll also go through them. And lastly, we'll have malware analysis and penetration testing. So we'll also discuss about that. We'll talk about what are the different types of malware analysis process, what are the different ways in which you can perform it, and what is penetration testing and how to perform it. I'll give you a glimpse of the process also. So that is for the agenda, what we'll be further discussing in today's webinar. And then we have is the first one, which is ethical hacking. So guys, I would also further discuss ethical hacking. Now, you might have seen it previously also that in today's scenario, people are very interested in hacking. It's something that attracts them. And when we talk about ethical hacking, so before we talk about ethical hacking, guys, we should know what is hacking, correct? And it's something that people are very attracted to. Why is it so? Because it's very, it's depicted as very mysterious. So hacking is basically using your knowledge, using the right tools, tricks, technologies to further find out the weaknesses in someone's system, in your target, and further exploiting those weakness to further gain entry into someone's system. So you're trying to further intrude into your target's system by exploiting the weakness they have. That is hacking. Now, hacking is not always illegal also. If you're doing it, let's say as per the request of your target, if you're doing it for a legal if you're doing it for a legal purpose and your aim as well as your motive defines whether it's right or wrong. It cannot always be wrong. So ethical hacking basically means you are using all this knowledge, the tools, the technologies, the strategy you're developing in order to further attack someone. But your purpose is to further discover their weakness and further secure the system. So here, the main difference that comes between a hacker and an ethical hacker is also the same, just like the definition here. So hacker is someone who uses this knowledge, this resources to further perform some illegal activity. So basically, here the goal is to disrupt your service, maybe to corrupt your data, or maybe to disable your services. So it's not something that is very conducive. Whereas ethical hacker is someone who is using the same skills, same knowledge, same tools, but for the defensive purpose. He's using it to further secure your systems, to evaluate your security and go for resolving out the issues, the weaknesses that are present in it. So you might have heard about a very famous saying also that says that in order to catch an attacker, in order to catch a hacker, you have to think like one. So that's why when we talk about ethical hacking, we also study about a methodology which attacker used to stage an attack. Because at the end of the day, you're simulating the attacker's activity, the same attack pattern, to find out vulnerabilities in your services, in your assets. So that's why I said it's simulation of attacker activities to evaluate the vulnerability, to discover new vulnerabilities. So here what happens is now that mainly when we talk about an attack, so it includes a goal, a motive, as well as the method you're going to use to stage an attack on someone. Now, many a times, the goal may be to steal information. Many a times, it could be, so instead of motive, because they do represent the same thing, we can further include here the resources. So goal can be to disrupt your service, to deface your websites, to take revenge on you. There can be multiple reasons. Many a times it's just for the sake of curiosity, because sometimes organizations are so well secured that the attacker becomes curious that, will I be able to hack into the website of this organization? Will I be able to crack down this particular firewall they have in place that is so much secure? So many a times it's due to the curiosity as well they stage an attack. It's not always to steal your data. It's not always to bring down your services. Then the method the attacker is using, this could include your strategy, the approach he's taking. Now every attacker has different approaches. Some may want to further send you an email that contains a malicious link. Some may send it as an attachment. Now many a times the attacker may further go for embedding the malware into a website you frequently visit. So there can be different ways in which attack can be initiated, different strategies, different tools that can be used to stage an attack. So in ethical hacking, we are using the same process, same tools, but the intent is different. Now it's not to further disrupt your service, it's not to cause any adverse impact on the target, but to secure it. So when we talk about the hacking methodology, so we have five broad steps, the first one being the reconnaissance part. Now reconnaissance basically means that you are trying to gather as much information about your target as you can. So you're trying to gather as much information as possible about your target, and from that information you can later analyze it and then try to further go for finding out the weakness, vulnerabilities that you can exploit. Now here you can get this information from multiple sources. You can get it from your browsers. We have different browsers and every browser provides you somewhat different information. You may have many commonalities also, but you have difference in the information you get from the browsers. Like if I say Google Chrome, Google Chrome provides you more of a general information. Whereas if I say Microsoft Edge, that provides you maybe an IP address range. So that depends on how you're also further customizing your search. You can get it from browsers. You can further use different tools available. We have different websites that provide you this information, different frameworks available from where you can gather the information from: Facebook pages, Instagram pages of the website. So you can gather information from there. Later on, You can also go for using this information. Now, let's say if you have a target which is ABC. So within ABC, now you are able to find out the IP address range using your reconnaissance. So you may say that the IP address range is from this one. Now, how do you further know that within this range, which system to attack? Because there are a lot of systems here. So what we do now is we try to further simplify it. We go for scanning this range. Scanning is basically you're trying to further collect more information by interacting with the target. So you go for scanning the complete range of IPs to further see which IP is further active, which host is currently in the active state. So once you scan it, you will be able to see the result host is up. Then you might also see some hosts are down. So from there, you can further finalize, you can get specific host details which are active, and then you can go for scanning those hosts to find what are the ports that are open in the host. Because open ports serve as a very serious vulnerability. We will also discuss what is vulnerability. Vulnerability basically, it's a weakness within your system. It can be a weakness. It can be a loophole within your security. It could be a design flaw within your hardware, within your software. So this can be anything. Your open ports. You might have certain ports open within your systems, which are not needed. They have been unused for a long period of time. So at that point also, it happens that they can act as a entry point for the attacker. Certain services are running which you do not require. So they can also further act as a vulnerability for him. Let's say if you have FTP service, which is not considered very secure. Why? Because this service further transmits your data in plain text format. That means it's transferring your data in a format that is very easy to see. If you can get the packets of FTP protocol, so you will be able to see what is included within the packet. You will be able to see that detail. So we go for disabling those services as a security measure, but it can be used by the attacker to gain access to your systems. So we scan for operating system versions. We scan for what services are running. What is the version of these services? Now, let's say you find out that a particular host within this range is using Windows 10. Now, when you know that it's further using Windows 10 as an operating system, so then you can try to find vulnerabilities present within Windows 10. Then you can go for further evaluating the whole target to see whether these vulnerabilities have been resolved or not. You can go for exploiting them. So there are a few databases. Some of you might be familiar with them and others may not be. So what I'll do is I'll also take you through the databases, have a quick look at them so that you will be able to see how we can find those vulnerabilities. Once you go for scanning, you find out the vulnerabilities, you create your payload that you would be sending to the target. And when it's within the target system, it will exploit the vulnerability, gain access to the system, and further go for installing the malware. Now, once that is done, you have to also ensure that you maintain your access. Now, why maintaining access is important? Because every host has certain security controls in place. You might have seen nowadays almost all systems, all PCs, they come with firewalls. And every user also has an antivirus in place. So the attacker has to further ensure that he is not detected by them. He is further able to persist there. Gaining an entry is easy, but remaining within the system is difficult. So that is the reason why he tries to further increase his permissions. Let's say he might have compromised a user account which was having very little privilege, maybe just an entry-level user account that the attacker compromised. Now, this account has limited privileges. You cannot access more critical data from it. So he tries to increase his privileges and maybe gain the privileges of an admin account. So he can perform more activities. He can delete his tracks also. That is your clearing tracks. So once you have gained more privileges, you work upon your objective, you work upon what is it that you wanted to do. You have to also ensure you remove the traces of attack. Because you would not want to be detected, right? You would want to further ensure that even if you're attacking someone, you are further gaining access to his system, performing various activity, but you would not want to be detected because that can be somewhat harmful to you. So you try to remove your traces. So what that can include, it can include the logs, which are basically the events that are being further happening within the system itself are being logged. So you may try to delete those. If you have installed any malware file, if you have installed any tools, you would like to further delete them. You try to hide these tools in order to avoid detection. So that is basically a representation of the attack methodology process. So what I'll do is I'll stop sharing the screen now and I'll further take you through the databases for vulnerability and I'll share my browser screen. So guys, the first database that we would be going through is the CVE database. That is Common Vulnerability Exposure Database. It's maintained by the Mitre organization. And here basically you can find the details about all the vulnerabilities that have been discovered so far. You will be able to get those details. So what I'll do is I'll just go to the database, search CVE list, and there we can look for vulnerabilities. So here you can either search using the keyword or you can go for using a unique ID that is provided to every vulnerability within the particular database. So let's say if I'm searching the vulnerabilities for HTTP protocol. So once I click on submit, it will show me all the vulnerabilities that have been found so far for HTTP. So this is the depiction of all the vulnerabilities. Now, let's say if we want to check some of the vulnerabilities, like the first one, if we go forward with, that is CVE 2024 and the number. So you can see this is the year in which the vulnerability has been found. And this is the ID of the vulnerability. And then you have as a description of the vulnerability, some references where you can get more information about the vulnerability. So you might also say that this information is somewhat limited. It's not very detailed information, correct? So that's why you also have another database, which is NVD, National Vulnerability Database. It is maintained by the NIST organization, National Institutes of Science and Technologies. So you can further reference the vulnerability here. You will be able to get more detailed information. Okay. So here this vulnerability has been received by NVD, but has not been currently analyzed. So the score that has been provided, NIST hasn't provided a score for it yet, but CNA is another vulnerability database. They have provided it a score of 8.7. That is considered pretty high. Then you can further see some advisory solutions. When it's analyzed by NIST, you will be able to see it here. If a patch is available, you will be able to see it here. Which weakness it is exploiting, you will be able to see the details here. Which software configuration is affected by the vulnerability, you will be able to find it. So these are the two vulnerability databases that I wanted to further show here. And then we further go forward with the next topic that we have within the slide. So I'll share my screen. And let's go to the slideshow mode. Okay. And then we have is the next one, which is threat actor. Now we have different types of attackers. We have different types of people, different types of attackers. The first one is hacker. Now, previously, it was further taken as a notion, very frequently believed, that hacker is someone who is a loner. He is someone who acts alone. He doesn't have any team, any support. He's working alone. But that is not the case. You may have some loners, but still the people, the hackers, they try to further group themselves in multiple organizations. They form groups. Now, we have the criminal groups. So these can be basically the people who try to stage attack on you. These can be your not only the cyber criminals, but also the other ones. So these people basically, they do it solely for the sake of profit. They might have been given some money for it. They can stage an attack on you, maybe try to physically intrude into your premises. We have nation state attackers. Now, these may be further employed by the countries. Let's say if we have two countries, A and B. So A might further employ hackers to hack into the systems of B, maybe the government websites, it can be your military databases, your systems, to gain information. To gain military information, it can be used. So they can be hired by the nation. You may have corporate spies. Now, corporate spies can be someone who is sent by your competitors. Your competitors may send their people into your hiring process, and when they are a part of your organization, they get hired. Then these people, they further transfer your information, your data to the competitors, which give them a, you can say, advantage, competitive advantage over you. So we can have corporate spies. Then we have is malicious insiders. Now, when we are saying it's an insider, that means it's someone who is a part of your organization, correct? So it's a person who is a part of your organization, and this person wants to stage an attack on you. So since we are talking about malicious insider, that means this person is doing it deliberately. He knows it is wrong and it's still doing it. Maybe because he wants to take revenge. Many a times because he's treated unfairly. And it could be due to financial advantage that he is getting by maybe selling your information on dark web or selling it to your competitors. So we do have malicious insiders. Then we have is the hacktivist. Now, hacktivists basically are the attackers who further hack for a particular cause. Maybe it's to support a political agenda. And so they do it for a cause. Maybe let's say in some countries, many services may not be available. So these people, they may hack into that country's services and allow the service to be used by the citizens. So they do it for a cause. Whereas terrorist groups are also hackers. Now these people, let's say they have a very strong belief that they believe in. Now, what they do is these people, they may want to let other people know about their beliefs. And for that reason, they may hack the systems. Maybe you might have seen it in movies also that many a times you see the all the systems, all the TVs within the city, within the screens of the city, they show the same thing. That is to let people know what you are thinking, what is your belief. So these people, they do it. And they try to also protect themselves so as not to be identified. They may later claim that we are the one who did it, but usually they don't go for identifying themselves. So these are the different types of attackers we have. Okay, and then we have is vulnerabilities. Now, vulnerability is basically the weakness that is present in your assets. Now, asset can be something that is of value to the organization. Now, this asset is something valuable. So we have two types of assets, basically. We have tangible assets and we have intangible assets. Now, tangible is something that you can physically perceive, like your hardwares, the people who are working within the organization, your infrastructure. It's all a part of your tangible assets. Whereas intangible asset basically is something you cannot physically perceive. Your data, your digital information, your applications, then your intellectual property rights, your trademarks, these are all included within your intangible assets. Now, they can be further, they may have a weakness within them, which can be exploited by the attacker. He can try to exploit it and gain entry, gain access to your systems using it. Now, what are some examples of such vulnerabilities? We have the TCP/IP protocol vulnerabilities. We do have certain protocols in place which are considered insecure. And if you are using those protocols, it's very easy to further see what you're transmitting. And that can be used as a source of information collection. And you can use it in later attack. Let's say we have HTTP. We have FTP. We have Telnet. We have SMTP. So these are a few protocols that are not considered secure because they transfer your data in plain text format and they do not use any encryption. They do not further encode your data into an unreadable format before sending it so that anyone can see it without proper protection. Next, we have is user account vulnerabilities. So many a times you may not have secure passwords for your accounts. You might have seen many a times that people usually have that notion that if they use password, this word as a password of their account, no one will guess it. But that's not the case. Usually the attacker first tries these commonly used and guessed passwords. You might have seen some others also, like this one. This is also a very widely used password. Then we have admin 123 and 1234567 89. So these are some commonly used password, easily guessable ones. So if you are using these weak passwords, it's very easy to guess. It's very easy to hack into your accounts. Next one is with the infrastructure you're installing, with the application softwares you're bringing in, they do have default passwords and settings. So if you're using the default passwords, then you're still leaving yourself prone to attacks because there are multiple websites and vendors, multiple pages on the internet that give you a list of all default passwords which are used by different vendors. So attacker can find that information from there. And the default setting is the easiest to break through. So make sure you customize your assets as per your needs and requirements. You have another vulnerability, which is misconfiguration. Now that is basically when the hardware you're installing, the software, the application you're implementing, many a times it's not configured properly. It can be due to lack of knowledge or improper skills. So that can leave your asset open to attacks. We have network device vulnerabilities. Let's say we have firewall in place. We have routers, switches. So if these are not configured properly, they can be prone to attacks. And at the same time, you have to ensure that you keep these devices up to date with the recent security updates provided by the vendor, the patch they are providing, so that they remain protected, they remain secure, they are helping you to resolve the incoming request that is coming to you. Filter it out. So these were a few examples of vulnerabilities. Now, this is just one of the representations of what is the vulnerability landscape for the year 2023. So in the year 2023, a total of 26,447 vulnerabilities were discovered. And here, apart from in that 100, 26% of the vulnerabilities were the one that had an exploit available. So you were having an exploit available which can be used to exploit the vulnerability. Now, then we had 206 vulnerabilities which had the weaponized exploit code. That means if you use this code, then you will be able to further exploit the vulnerability, gain access to the system, and introduce the malware. We have 115 vulnerabilities which were further exploited by the known threat actors. That means you may be further able to profile certain attackers. So 115 were such vulnerabilities which were known by such attackers. They are used in order to stage attacks. Then we had 109 vulnerability which were further listed out by CISA. It's one of the organizations in UK that further is responsible for the security. So they further published 109 known vulnerabilities that were exploited. 97 vulnerabilities were still present, which was not listed by CISA, but they were known and exploited. 20 vulnerabilities were exploited by ransomware. Now, ransomware is a type of malware in which the attacker tries to lock you out of your own system, your own files, and then he demands a ransom from you. So unless you are able to pay the ransom, your files will not be accessible to you. They will remain coded. They will remain encrypted. 15 vulnerabilities were exploited by the malware, and we had 8 vulnerabilities which were named. So you may have certain name provided to the vulnerabilities that are identified. So 8 were such vulnerabilities. So this is a graphical representation of all the vulnerabilities that have been discovered in the year 2023. Okay. So then we have is the web application vulnerability. So this is a list which is provided by OWASP. Now OWASP is a non-profit organization that provides you guidelines, best practices for creating secure application and making sure they are secure. So we have broken access control. This vulnerability basically is further present to your access control mechanisms. That includes your authentication, includes your authorization and auditing. Basically verifying the user, assigning him permissions and monitoring the activity. So there is an issue with these three processes. It's not very robust enough. You're not able to further make sure that the user is well screened before he's allowed access. Sometimes the encrypted the algorithms you are using for performing encryption may not be strong enough, due to which it's easily deciphered by the attacker. Third one is injection attacks vulnerability. That means your application is not validating the inputs that is provided to it, due to which attacker is able to provide customized queries to the application. Next one is insecure design, which basically means application is not secure by design. That means by default, there are vulnerabilities present. Sometimes it could be misconfigurations. Your application is not configured properly. You may be using certain codes, configurations which are outdated. They are not secure enough. Your authentication mechanism is not very robust. Attacker is able to bypass it. You may have certain of your data integrity failures, software failures. Your information may not be trustworthy and complete. It might be modified without prior permissions. Next one is security logging and monitoring failures. So that is when you're not further enabling logging within your application. So you will not be able to further evaluate what actually happened because you don't have a record for it. So that is the reason we have it as a serious vulnerability. Next is server-side request forgery. That is another kind of vulnerability. Attacker may set up his own server and he can try to further let you connect to his service, then sniff the traffic and further use your credentials to stage attack on someone else. So these are basically the web application vulnerabilities we have, the top 10 vulnerabilities provided by OWASP. Then we have a social engineering. Social engineering basically means you are trying to collect information, you're trying to gather information from people. You're trying to extract information from them. So basically, many a times people are not aware about how important the information they have is, due to which they very easily leak it out. So once that happens, attacker is able to gain information from them. Common targets can be help desk people, technical support, and system admins. Because these people, they inherently they have that within their job responsibility to help others. So when they get such fraudulent calls, they get such, they are targeted by the attackers, they reveal information. So these are a few types of social engineering attacks. We have impersonation, creating scenarios, phishing attack, wishing, smishing, baiting, waterhole attacks. Now, impersonation basically means attacker is trying to pretend to be someone else. He may send a mail that may look coming from bank, but it's coming from the attacker. And in that, he may create scenarios that, it's very urgent. We faced a network attack. We need you to log in again. Now, since it is looking like it's coming from the bank, you fall prey to it. That is your phishing attack. Now, when phishing is performed using a voice call, it's wishing. It's performed using SMS, it's smishing. And you basically try to lure the victims into clicking on the link. That is baiting. So these are the different types of social engineering attack. You basically pretend to be someone and call them and further try to make sure that these people reveal information. You pretend to be very friendly to them. Whereas malware is basically code, it's basically the malicious code that may damage your system, may provide partial to full control of your system to the person who created the malware. We have different types of malware. Spyware, that helps the attacker to record your credentials, your typing, your credit card details, financial details. We have botnet malwares. So these are basically the compromised systems. A network of those systems is your botnets. Your adwares. Adwares is basically malware embedded within the ad. Trojans, it looks like a seemingly genuine software, but it's actually a malware in disguise. We have virus and worms. These are also malwares that spread very, very quickly. And ransomware is the one we just saw earlier. So these are the different types of malwares that are present. Then we have is APT. APT is another type of attack, basically, in which attacker is able to gain access to your system. And further, he performs whatever activity he needs to do and remain within the system without being detected. That is the main point. He remains within the system, you're not able to detect him, and he may be present within your systems for days, weeks, months, but it's not detected. So usually the goal for the attacker in staging an APT is to collect information, to gather your sensitive data secretly. So first he decides upon a target, find out his team members, accomplices who will help him stage an attack, gather all the tool, collect information about the target. Then he further looks to see what are the detection mechanisms a target has in place. Then he further go for deploying the attack. He further sends the malware to the victim, gains initial access. Then he tries to set up a command and control channel, a outbound connection from the victim, and further goes for enhancing his privileges. Then persist within the system. When you have more privileges, you can delete your tracks. Then he tries to further exfiltrate your data. Further collect your data, send it to another remote location, and go for covering his tracks and remain undetected. Because if you're not able to detect him, you don't see any traces, any unusual activity, it will be difficult for you to detect him. That's the reason he is able to stay within your systems. Then we have a malware analysis. Now, if you want to see, if you want to analyze a malware activity and attack, so basically malware analysis is the process by which we reverse engineer a malware to see where it is coming from, how it's further working, what libraries it's loading, what files it's interacting with, and what impact it is having on you. Why do we need to do it? because that will let you know that what are the potential impacts a malware can have on you, how severe they can be, what can be the affected user systems from it. We have two types of analysis, static and dynamic. Now, static analysis basically means that you are trying to further analyze your malware code, your source code of the malware. And from there, you're trying to find the details. Maybe you want to see what dynamic link library it's loading, what are the files it's interacting with. Whereas dynamic analysis basically means you try to run the malware file, and then you try to see how it's interacting, how it's further functioning, and what are the impacts it's having on your system. So you can either do this manually by yourself, or you can use automated tools that can help you facilitate the process, which is mentioned here: static, dynamic, manual, and automated. Okay. Then we have a pen testing. Pen testing, basically, it's the exercise by which the organization invites the pen testing team to further evaluate their systems, to evaluate their security posture of the organization. So basically, they simulate an attack and try to find out the vulnerabilities within the given scope of activity. Maybe they are further performing the test on specific assets. So they try to evaluate the security and find out vulnerabilities. We have types of testing. We have black box testing. That basically means you are not provided any information about your target. You just know this is your target. Then you try to gather information and further evaluate for vulnerabilities, simulate an attack. So you can say this one is from the viewpoint of an attacker. We have white box. Here information is provided to the testers. Maybe you're providing them information about the network topology or other details. So which is providing you more in-depth analysis of your scope, of your targeted assets. Whereas gray box is somewhat between black and white. So here the information is provided, but it's less as compared to a white box pen testing. So that is what we have in pen testing. So guys, you might have a question that pen testing and ethical hacking, they might be, what is the difference between them, correct? So pen testing is basically performed on a specific, you can say with a specific goal. Maybe on some specific parts of your infrastructure. Because it's a time-consuming process, you have constraints of time, budget, and resource constraints. So it's done on specific assets, your specific goal. Whereas ethical hacking, it's more broader in the sense, takes more time, and you need to further evaluate a lot of things. It's not specific to a particular goal. It's more broader in the scope. Okay, so guys, then I'll also further show you a few scanning methods that we can further go for using. So I'll end the slideshow. And then I'll take you to that process. So we also have a process of penetration testing. It's same as the attack methodology because we are simulating the attack. The last step is different, which is preparing reports. After you are able to perform the test, we have to create a report that includes all the vulnerabilities you have found as well as how to resolve them. So guys, here I'm just using one of the VMs to show you one tool that you can further use to perform the scan on the system. So you might be familiar with that tool. Some of you might have seen it. So let me just zoom in. The tool is Nmap. Now, let's say you want to scan a particular host. So we can provide the domain name of the host and Nmap will help you to scan it. It will help you to see whether the host is active, what are the ports open within the host, what service is running on it. So it might take some time to complete it, but you will be able to get the results. So let me just see. Okay, it will take some time. So let me just scan another one which can give us more detailed information. I'll just check the other host we have in place and use it. Because we have time constraints today, so we'll scan some other host in its place. That can be done a bit earlier. And map. So this is one of the websites that is for a university. So we'll be able to get some details from here. And guys, that's also the last depiction we have for today. So I guess it's taking a 1 or 2 minutes to complete it. So I'll show you a picture of what the output looks like in the meantime. Okay, so guys, it's something like this. You see the scan results, the host is up. I guess it's not very clear. Now it should be. Okay, so you're able to see after the scan is completed, host is up. This is the port open, and you can see how many closed ports are there, how many filtered ports are there. You will be able to see those details just like here. Starting the scan, completed. So you are able to see host is up. Similarly, you can see the ports that are open and the service that is running on the ports. So that is a simple depiction of Nmap. You can also use within Nmap, you can try to find out what operating system is being used. By the host, you can see the version of those scannings, and you will be able to further see more detail about the host also. So guys, that was all for this session from my side. And thank you for today's session. Okay, we do have one question, that is, do cloud service providers allow for pen test? So they would be going forward with pen test, that is true. And but here it's depending upon if they are the one who is further performing it. They do have certain limitation and they may have very less transparency for it, but they do go for pen testings in order to further secure the systems more. Okay, so then we do have a few more questions, I see. Okay, you can do find the audit logs, you can evaluate them. That is true. And okay, you can review the log file, you can get the network traffic, you can analyze it. Now, how is broken access control different from security logging and monitoring failures? Okay, so broken access control basically means that whatever access control mechanism you have in place is further not very robust, it's not very strong. And that is also the reason why attacker is able to bypass it. Maybe within your access control, you are revealing that username is not right or the password is not right. So that basically means if one of them is showing not right, then other one is true. So that can be one way. Okay, so guys, as for the CGRC course, you can further contact with Adam. And as for the attendance and the slide, you can further contact Adam for it and he would be able to clarify on it. I have also further shared the email ID with you. If you do have any query, anything you would like to confirm or further check with, you can use this email ID and you can find the information here. You can further continue using the mail ID. So basically, as for the tool that I showed just now, so that tool is Nmap. It's usually present if we talk in Linux system. It's already installed there. You can just use Nmap, you can type it, and then you will be able to use it. If you're wanting to use in the Windows system, you will have to download it from the internet. It's freely available. You can download it and then go for using it. Yeah, we do have a lot of importance on the legal hold, because everything that you're doing, whether it's your ethical hacking, whether it's your pen testing, it's necessary that you're doing it as per the laws and regulations. You have to ensure that whatever activity you're doing, whether it's scanning your systems, whether you're further going forward with maybe finding out the vulnerabilities, you are providing certain services, it's necessary that you go for following the laws and regulation. Let's say in certain countries, it's very necessary that you follow the laws and regulation. There are certain mandatory laws to follow. So that depends on the area where you're providing your services in and where your premises. Your own countries may have some specific laws that you have to follow. You have global laws that can be followed. So that's it all for today's guys. And now Adam will take it over from here. And that would be all for today. Have a good day ahead, guys.